गुड आफ्टरनून सर, दिस इज शेखर चतुर्वेदी फ्रॉम एनआईडीएम। डॉक्टर साहब गुड आफ्टरनून। राजमणि जी गुड आफ्टरनून।
सुनी नहीं रहे।
शुड वी स्टार्ट?
राजमणि सर, शैल वी स्टार्ट? आवाज
राजमणि जी गुड आफ्टरनून।
हेलो
शेखर जी। यस सर,
गुड आफ्टरनून। मैं ऑडिबल?
यस सर, ऑडिबल सर। गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
ओके सर, थैंक यू।
शैल वी स्टार्ट सर?
हाँ, नेम दिस टाइम।
राजमणि जी कैन वी स्टार्ट?
जस्ट 2 मिनट्स सर।
ओके सर, गुड आफ्टरनून। Should we start now?
Okay, sir. మన వాయిస్ వెళ్తుందో లేదో తెలియదు. వస్తుందా?
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్, గుడ్ ఆఫ్టర్నూన్ వన్ అండ్ ఆల్. ఐ అరుణ్ వర్మ వెల్కమ్ యూ టు దిస్ వన్ డే వెబినార్ ఆన్ ఎమర్జెన్సీ ఆపరేషన్ సెంటర్. ఫ్రెండ్స్, దిస్ ఇస్ అ ప్రోగ్రామ్ విచ్ ఇస్ జాయింట్లీ ఆర్గనైజ్డ్ బై నేషనల్ ఇన్స్టిట్యూట్ ఆఫ్ డిజాస్టర్ మేనేజ్మెంట్, మినిస్ట్రీ ఆఫ్ హోమ్ అఫేర్స్ అండ్ గ్రేటర్ విశాఖపట్నం మున్సిపల్.
మనకి డిస్ప్లే రావట్లేదు.
గ్రేటర్ విశాఖపట్నం మున్సిపల్ కార్పొరేషన్. So this is a webinar on emergency operation center. As we know and aware that EOC is a main and kind of a basic thing which we should understand and have a kind of a knowledge to understand these things, that in any kind of emergency or any disaster when we face, that EOC has been implemented at a one place there where we can generate or we can give information and or we can transfer information one place to another, that what kind of a things are going on. For after this particular webinar, the participants are in the position to sensitize on the basic of EOC, emergency operation center, and its functioning, to provide information on the emergency support functioning, or to apprise participant about the linkages with the EOC, with incident response system. So this is a one day webinar, and in which we will be covering two topics, that are EOC overview and EOC and its linkages with incident response system, which will be covered by Sri Shekhar Chaturvedi, assistant professor at NIDM. Now I hand over the dice to Sri Rajamaniji from GVMC to give proceed program further. I hand over the dice to Rajamani sir.
Good afternoon and welcome to everyone. Arunji, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Please continue.
Good afternoon and well. Good afternoon and welcome to everyone. I take pleasure to welcome you all for today's training program on Emergency Operations Center, conducted by the National Institute of Disaster Management, New Delhi, in collaboration with Disaster Management Cell Sustainability Resilience Program, UNDP GUI Project, Greater Visakhapatnam Municipal Corporation. established under the Commissioner Greater Visakhapatnam Municipal Corporation to implement the Sustainability and Resilience Program. The program, which was started in the GVMC to continue the UNDP GUA project activities and other development initiatives. The SRU, it will work directly or through its four wings, namely Environment Cell, Climate Cell, Disaster Management Cell and Human Resource Development Cell, to achieve long-term sustainability and resilience in the city of Visakhapatnam and the state of Andhra Pradesh. The Visakhapatnam, being a coastal and industrial city, it is often vulnerable to various kinds of hazards. The city has experienced both natural and man-made disasters, and there is a need to strengthen procedures for effective emergency management in the city level. Thanks to NADM, Shekhar Chaturvedi ji, ED sir, and resource persons Mr. Balaji ji, and all participants attending this training program. I wish to share one information that our municipal commissioner, Dr. G. Srijina, has transferred as Director Industries. So on behalf of our GVMC, Greater Visakhapatnam Municipal Corporation, our Chief Engineer, sir, Mr. Ravi Krishna Raju, he will deliver our keynote address. Now, may I request our Chief Engineer, sir, to deliver keynote address on behalf of GVMC. Thank you.
Very good afternoon to everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to the training program on Emergency Operations Center being conducted by the National Institute of Disaster Management, New Delhi, in collaboration with the Sustainability and Resilience Unit, UNDP GUI Project, Greater Visakhapatnam Municipal Corporation. I extend my warmest welcome to all the participants across the state of Andhra Pradesh and India. India is vulnerable to a variety of natural and man-made disasters which are hindering the country's growth. Many people have lost their lives and crores of people were affected in many incidents of natural disasters in India, according to a report by UN Office for Disaster Risk Reduction. The state of Andhra Pradesh is also susceptible. Concept crucial terms by the government agencies in association with the stakeholders is need of the hour to save lives of people and minimize damages which can happen due to disasters. Establishment of emergency operation centers, that is EOCs, is very essential to handle emergencies effectively. These EOCs are central command and control facilities responsible for carrying out the principles of emergency preparedness and management at the times of disasters. At most of the cities in our country, emergency operation centers have been establishing as a temporary setup only or giving EOC responsibility to any section of the city or local administration. It is near of the hour to set up EOCs at district or central level.
Necessary infrastructure, and they should be ready for the full-fledged operations at any time. It is also important to train the key officials and staff on EOCs so that they can establish our bases where incidents occur. In Visakhapatnam, our GVMC has experience of handling disasters and emergencies. Previously, we have handled Hudhud cyclone during 2014, and recent cyclone Gulab. Industrial accidents were also happened many times in our city. So firmly believe that this NIDM training program on Emergency Operations Center will definitely help participants in enhancing their knowledge and establishment of EOC and local emergency operations centers.
उनका भी खत्म हो गया. राजामणि सर, वी आर नॉट गेटिंग योर वॉइस. हेलो राजामणि सर, इज आई ऑडिबल? सर आपको आ रही है? Thank you, sir. And now I would like to invite Sri Shekhar Chaturvedi, sir, from NIDM, and sir has a vast experience in the field of disaster management since 2000. Sir is associated with the institute from I think 1998, when it was a center for NCDM, and later on it was introduced at the National Institute of Disaster Management after the enactment of Act 2005. So sir is also associated with the field of disaster response and recovery division and looking after the incident response system, disaster management plan, and the community based disaster management preparedness, and many more things. So I would like to invite you, sir, for your sections, and please give a kind of a welcome address from an IDM side. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Arun. So I thank GVMC for giving us the opportunity to collaborate with them and conduct the program on Emergency Operations Center. We all know that Emergency Operations Center is the nerve center of the of any operations in terms of emergencies or any other operation. We usually maybe virtually we establish an EOC. So this program becomes very important in terms of disasters, because every time whenever we get the information of disasters, impending disasters, we start establishing the EOC, and we activate that EOC, which has been already prepared, already established. So with this pretext and context, we are conducting this program with GVMC. And I convey best wishes from our executive director side, who is in the ministry for some emergency meeting. So he has conveyed his best wishes. And as far as National Institute of Disaster Management is concerned, we started as a center in Indian Institute of Public Administration way back in 1995, graduated to an institute as National Institute of Disaster Management in 2003, and got the statutory status when the with the enactment of Disaster Management Act in 2005. So right from the establishment in 1995 as a center and later on as an institute, we have been working in various fields of disaster management, capacity building mainly, through training, research, documentation, awareness, advocacy, etc. And we have been also assisting and collaborating with different state institutions for preparation of disaster management plans and the process that is prepared for disaster management policies. So this is what NIDM is all about. And I again, once again, thank GVMC for giving us the opportunity and Government of Andhra Pradesh for giving us the opportunity to interact with the participants who are attending this program on Emergency Operations Center. So with this, we come to an end to the inaugural session. As a program, we will be discussing the overview of EOC and its relationship with incident response system. Although we had requested Balaji, USFS expert, to share his experiences on Emergency Operations Center, but due to a family emergency, he has rushed to Hyderabad and will be joining somewhere in the later part of the program. So by that, I start my presentation, which is basically Balaji's presentation. So I'll be sharing that presentation with you all. And we'll be sharing the presentation to you all. Thank you. So hope my presentation is visible.
Yes, sir.
So we will be covering this overview and the relationship of IRS with Emergency Operations Center in this 1.5 hour session. So when we talk of disaster, what comes to our mind? The first thing that comes to our mind is devastation. And for devastation, management of that devastation, what we need? We need resources. We need right information at right point of time. There will be a large number of organizations who will be there to help and who will be there to manage the situation. Be it when we talk of state government, be it revenue department, be it disaster management department, be it police or home department, be it the local administration, be it the district administration, the municipal administration, majority of them are involved in management of the disasters. So there is a need, there is an imperative need of coordination among those all stakeholders who are there, and even community is also there. So there's the need of coordination is foremost important, because to avoid any untoward incident within the responders part. So that coordination is needed. We need, when we are going to conduct a response activity, so we need a very much clear directions, delegation of authority, and the policy that we have to follow, the action plan that we have to follow. We need that clarification in terms of effective response. Why we are talking of response? Because we are talking of, we'll be talking of IRS. So we need that policy clarification, that policy clarity in the preparedness part also, and in the response part also. So that is the need when we talk of disaster. These things come to our mind. And another thing very important is that ever change, we see in every disaster that there is a ever changing scenario. That is, it might go towards the complexity, or it might stabilize at what it has stuck. So that changing in situation and along with the changing situation of the weather, that again is one thing that now IMD is predicting through now casting, effectively predicting that. So that awareness of the environmental situation and the ground reality is what is needed when we talk of management of a disaster or we talk of preparedness of a disaster. So that situational awareness is very much the major thing that situational awareness gives when we are in the planning stage, that is in the zero period where there is no disaster, we prepare the disaster management plan. So there also the ground truthing of the situation of the area where we are making the plan and what are the vulnerabilities of that area, the physical vulnerabilities of that area, the economic vulnerability of that area, and the situation of that area, that is locational facility of that area, is very much important. So situational awareness is much more important when we talk of disasters, because we are dealing with the life of the people. Another, when we are talking of coordination, then it is needed at the time of disasters also, but when there is no disaster, that is it's a zero period, then also all the stakeholders who are there, who will be responsible for response, who will be responsible for mitigation, they all need a close coordination and close connect with one another. They should know the policies of each other. They should know the ground realities of each other. They should know the resource capabilities of each other. They should know the resource management of each other, so that when and hierarchy of each other, that whom to contact when there is a problem, when there is an emergency or there is a problem. So that is what is needed when we talk of disaster. And since we talk of disaster and there is a lot of stakeholders who are coming in for response, for mitigation, for help, so there is the underlying thing that there might be a chaos, confusion site of situation at the site or at the management part. So it is all the more important that this problem of confusion, chaos, and unpredictability of the situation must also be catered to when we are managing a disaster. And last but not the least, timely and effective action, decision making is what is needed when to effectively manage a disaster. If the time lag is there, or the effectiveness of the decision making is not there, or there is some say lag in decision making, then that crucial gap of the time might cause major problems when we are talking of disasters. So that is what is much more important when we talk of disasters. So on-site situation, when we if we are talking of incident response system, then on-site situation, we have the IIT on-site working in full swing, all the possible resources available, all the possible team members available, all the positions, say all the functions of the positions being activated. So that is when the disaster strikes. So you have that teams on ground who have the resources, who must have the resource information of the resources, what information, what resources can be taken from the surrounding situation. With that focus, they should prepare the tactical plan. Tactical plan is basically the executable plan of operations. So that plan is prepared while assessing the entire situation, even the weather situation also, and the available resources, and the resources that can be catered to or procured from nearby areas. So that with all this, the tactical plan is made and tried to execute. But when we are trying to execute the tactical plan, then what we need the gap areas to be fixed, that is the gaps in the resources procurement or availability of the resources to be fixed by mobilizing the resources from certain areas where they can be either procured or they can be provisioned. So that is what is needed by the incident response team. So and when we talk of the EOC, we talk of the EOC and we see that it is a little different from the control room, but we see that the emergency operations center is basically will be addressing the problems of the IRT, the incident response teams, and the problems that disaster throws open when it strikes. So we need that EOC in that context. So the next slide gives you the definition of EOC. Why we are talking of definition of the EOC? Because often the EOC is being confused with the control room. It is a sort of control room, but it is much more, it has much more bigger roles to play than the mere control room. So the definition of the EOC is very much needed. So the definition basically is a location where coordination of information, provisioning of the resources, support to the site operations is done through various technical gadgets, various electronic gadgets, and various decision-making tools. So that is what can be taken care of. So that location is known as the emergency operation center. So it can be physical, wherein you have the structure of EOC all fitted with various amenities, various facilities, or it can be a temporary facility. That is, it can be in a mobile van, or maybe somewhere it can be located somewhere near the situation where it is safety. So when we sum up all the things, then what we come out with is that a system that supports emergency operations center is basically a location, a system that supports incident planning, incident response, incident resources, and stabilizing the situation systematically through providing the information, mobilizing and providing the resources, and providing the policy information to everybody so that there is coordination among the stakeholders. So this is what an emergency operations center is all about. Now, why we need the EOC? What is the purpose of EOC? Why we cannot do away with EOC? Why we need that there should be some place where the decision making should take place? Can it be done in DM's office, or can it be done in some somebody's residence? No. It can be a virtual thing. It can be a mobile thing. But there has to be a certain place where EOC has to function, because it needs various informations to analyze, to receive, and to pass it on to the site. So it needs a location. The location may be mobile, may be temporary or permanent, but a location is very much necessary. And what is the purpose? Why we establish the EOC? We establish the EOC, we all know that certain activities that are needed. What are the activities? Activities are coordination amongst the stakeholders who are responding or who are there to respond. Proper decision making so that the the agency that the stakeholders were responding, the responders, they have clear-cut ideas what to do, support, provide support to the site operations through mobilization and making resources available, proper decisions, proper policies, proper plans to execute. So this is the purpose for what EOC is established. So when we talk of disasters, we also come across one word that is called that disasters are local, but management can be global, but disasters are local. So that is one possibility, one effectiveness that EOC, the purpose of EOC is to manage the locally, the to manage the disasters or the incidents which occur because they are best managed at geographical locations, organization locations, or jurisdictional locations. So when we talk, when we come to the functions of EOC, the EOC we know, purpose of EOC now we have seen, why we need an EOC that we have seen, because to stabilize, to coordinate, to provide the information, the right kind of information, to establish a mechanism of coordination or information flow between the EOC and the site, to provide support to the responders, to provide support to the community at large. So all these activities are for this. We need a control room. We need a operations center to be established. Can be temporary. It can be permanent. But what are the functions that they do? From taking out the role that EOC plays, we decide on the functions of EOC. The first and the foremost function of the EOC is to have the clear-cut information about the situation and to disseminate that information, which is to be disseminated to different higher-ups and the sites, that this is what the situation is. And once that information is conveyed to the higher-ups, there is a linkage that is established between the EOC, the site, and the say higher-ups. So that is the management of information, which is very much important, and that is the prime function of EOC. The second prime function of EOC is that they should be well aware about the policies regarding where they are being established, policies and guidelines regarding what activity they can do, policy and guidelines that the responding agencies that are coming for their help have in place, so that all those policies can be jotted down and documented and conveyed to the site operations, that this agency is coming for your support, but for a certain period of time, and they have this policy that they'll only be involved in this activity. So that is what an EOC must provide a support to the site operations. Resources, which is very much important whenever management, mitigation, whatever activity you do, resources are very much important. So what activity EOC can do, because we see that EOC is basically the bridge between the site and the higher-ups for smooth operations on this site. So that is where emergency or the basic function of emergency operation center. So for that smoothness, the resources are a very much important cog in the wheel. So mobilization of the resources, allocation of the resources, availability of the resources, provisioning of the resources are what is major functions of EOC when it comes to the resource management. We all know that there are a lot many organizations that come in to manage a disaster. So that interagency coordination, inter-organization coordination, intra-coordination within their own EOC officials, that is the responsibility or function of EOC. Why coordination is important? We all know that since everybody who comes in has his or her own line of hierarchy, and if we don't have a coordination with one another, then we end up doing the activity which has already been done, or starting the activity which has already been done. We see in terms of training programs also that if you don't say inform the resource persons about what has been covered, then at times we have seen that all the resource person, they start with the same slide and end up taking more time. So that coordination, we all also see that when there is a developmental work going on in the city, so the road is laid down, later on a few days later the sewer pipeline will be laid down and the road will be cut, and then again when the road will be laid down, there will be BSNL or the power line that is coming, and the road again will be laid down. So lack of coordination is adding on to the cost of the work. Jurisdictional issues, they arise because disasters see no boundaries. So every time when the disaster strikes, you one district or one area has a certain jurisdictional location. So that is why policy and the area knowledge, area support is necessary, and which can be provided effectively by EOC, which has the maps, etc., located at its location. So that inter-jurisdictional problems can be addressed by inculcating a coordination between them. Planning, preparation of plans, very much important. EOC, because these cannot be developed on site, so it has to be developed somewhere and passed it on to the people who are working on the site. So that becomes important. So that place is again the emergency operations center, where incident action plan and the utilization of DM plans which are prepared can be done. Training, EOC is has a function of whosoever is manning the EOC or performing different activities within the EOC, they must get trained in that activity for effective utilization of the resources. So that is again one of the functions of the EOC. Now, when we talk of what we have seen usually for the EOC is that it is basically being utilized as a practical thing, that it is basically being utilized for responding to an incident or an event. So this slide gives you the major three functions of EOC in terms of effective response. One is policy and authority within the EOC for effective response, which EOC say delegation of roles and responsibilities, who will take the decision, what is, how the decision will be disseminated. So that policy and authority is available with the EOC, because when we talk of EOC, then the head of the EOC is basically the in the district level, it is, you know, district collector, and at the ward level, at the subdivisional level, it is the same. So that policy and authority is there with the EOC. Function of EOC is coordination and support. So it must provide information, resource support, decision support, and other said policy support and law support to the site operations. So interagency coordination, etc., it is one of the functions. On-scene incident management, when we are talking of incident response, when we are talking of effective response. So on-scene incident management is also very much necessary and one of the critical links of EOC with the effective response, that tactical operations are being planned for the incidents, so that information must be there with the EOC. What exactly are our priorities? That also is established by EOC in terms of response, in terms of people being evacuated. All these activities, the priorities are set by the EOC. And while it is in the while the people officials are in the EOC, they are responsible for monitoring, constant monitoring, effective coordination, and providing requisite information and resources to the site. Now, if these are so many functions of EOC, so whether EOC is a network, or EOC is a system, or EOC is just a body. So when we come down to the EOC as a network or as a system, so we see that it is a system of networks. You have national EOC, which is a network with international community, international support agencies, national support agencies, national operations is there. And the clear-cut rules of this is it facilitates the international support, it facilitates the international, say, donors. The linkage with the state EOC or the national EOC is that, again, they have a linkage to their down below, that is district EOC. Support agencies that are there, that is all other stakeholders, responsibility is with, lies with the state EOC. And whatever requirements are raised by the site operations, the responsibility of the state EOC is to fulfill that. The district EOC or the local EOC, the site EOC, as we see, that the site EOC, local EOC, so that EOC is basically responsible for the execution of the plans that have been made, execution of the policies that have been made. So they must be in close coordination and close connection with state EOCs, so that the decisions that are coming down from the national level, or decisions that are being taken at the state level, are being conveyed to the district level, and according to those directions, the district EOC is functioning on ground. And the actual function on ground is basically the incident response team that is functioning on site. So there has to be a close linkage of district or local EOC with that incident response team. So incident response team, if we say this was the hierarchy coming down, and when we talk of the information that is going up, is basically the request of resources, request of manpower, request of certain areas to be, facilities to be erected, is that comes from the incident response team, and it has to be tackled and addressed at the district level, and if not, then the same procedure till the national EOC is followed. So we see that EOC is basically a system of networks. And since it is a system of networks, it has to have some institutional arrangement. So what is the institutional arrangement? National, state, district, local. So this is where is the institutional arrangement of EOCs is there. And the linkages has to be established with the respective governments that are functioning, that are available, so that the policy decisions that has been taken are basically conveyed to the down below, and at the same time, the policies that are to be discussed and deliberated are to be conveyed to the respective government. So that is where the EOCs, institutional arrangement of the EOC or EOC as an institution is being thought of, because one, it is network, and the other thing is that it should be interoperable. Network and interoperable, that there has to be a close linkage to and fro from each level of the EOC till the incident response team, so that those activities are being designed and implemented on the ground. And when that institutional arrangement is set up, then there is no reason why your response will not be effective. So this is what we see, that EOC in this way, that EOC is different from the control room that we think of. Now, as we have been talking and we have been seeing in various emergency operations, is that there are lot many agencies that come in and come in for help and start functioning, even if not somebody from outside. There are lot many stakeholders within the district itself who come in for the help. So in that scenario of multi-agency, what is the role of EOC? See, we see the picture. This picture says that the top left corner of the picture is that there's a payment which has caved in, and two responders have come from PWD, from PhD, or like departments. They have come, they'll repair it and inform the situation to their higher up that this was the situation with these resources, this has been addressed. But now, if we go a little back to this, the payment, we might encounter that there was a landslide, a huge landslide that has taken place, which has given way to this present situation of the payment. So that landslide cannot be managed by these two people. So the situation it turns from the normal situation to a complex emergency. And when the complex emergency comes in, then it's not possible for two men or three men to address that complex emergency. It has to be a team effort, a multi-agency coordination effort, which can address the multi-agency or the complex emergency situation. So this is how the situation changes from normal situation to a complex emergency. And when the complex emergency comes in, EOC is a must. For first picture, the EOC was the mind of these two people who informed the higher ups that this was the situation, that this has been done. But for the multi or the complex situation, a physical EOC is a must. So when the physical EOC comes in, then there ought to be depending on the situation, what is exactly the complexity of the situation, and based on that complexity of the situation, the EOC is manned and EOC is managed. It may be a virtual conference with the site team, but people who assemble in an EOC are the people who are responsible for taking decisions. No person who has no delegated authority can sit in EOC and be effective. It is ought to be the person who has a delegated authority. He or she should sit in the EOC and take decisions there and then, because time is very crucial when we are talking of the emergencies. The left picture and the right picture are the situations of the EOC in the complex emergencies. Complex emergencies, what we see is that you have a cyclone, at the same time due to the cyclone you have flooding, and due to the flooding you have that inundation and the health issues. So these are complex emergencies. So once that complex emergency is coming, so you will be needing more than one agency to work on. So it becomes a multi-agency task. This is basically an example of multi-agency tasking. We all were part of Nasik Kumbh in 2015. Nasik is a place in Maharashtra. So we all were part of the management team or the trainer team who were there to implement the IRS on ground in a very huge situation of the Kumbh Mela. So you can see the emergency operation center that was established in Nasik for management of the Kumbh Mela, that is crowd management thing. So these are all the gadgets that are there. The TVs are there with latest technologies to have that multi-screening facility also, and having that latest information running on that. What is the current situation? So that situation information is caught hold of by the EOC and conveyed. Right information is conveyed to the on-ground people. The top right is the people from the department who are there to note down what is the situation and analyze that situation and give the analytical solution to the EOC officers who are sitting in the EOC so that they can take a decision. The three pictures at the bottom are basically from the another location of the Nasikum, that is Trimbakeshwar, and on-site EOCs were there. See, middle one, the lower middle one is the site EOC, on-site EOC, and this is the ADM collector's office, wherein the EOC has been set up. And right is basically the control room exactly within the EOC, wherein informations are coming in and decisions, hotlines, etc., police control room, they are taking the decisions on what is the current situation, what who is there to manage this situation. There was a situation there that an information was conveyed to the Nasik control room that one person has drowned at Ramkund. Ramkund is basically within the city. Center of the city. So Godavari River flows from it. And since it was a rainy season, so an information was conveyed to control room that one person has drowned. So immediately the control room took a decision and conveyed to the downstream people that they responded that you immediately take action. So the the downstream people, they immediately asked the divers to dive in. They caught hold of that person, took him to the hospital, and in the evening, doctors were able to revive that person. And he came in front of the media to say that I have been saved and I'm there. So it was luckily that during this huge event of Kumbh, there was not even a single death. And utilization of EOC and utilization of IRS was a good example at that moment of time. When we talk of benefits of EOC, common benefit is basically that it affects coordination, it affects effective response, it affects effective management of the resources. Information to and fro is what is being managed by the EOC in a better way. And since you are the one focal point which is providing information all around, then the picture that comes out in the open is a common picture. There is no separate information which is coming out, because the information is coming out from one source, that is EOC. So it establishes a common operating picture and common information to the site. It also helps decision support that is to be provided to the people who are working on site. So this is how things are managed in the EOC. It also, when the people with delegated authority are sitting in the EOC, they immediately prioritize the information that is received and accordingly take a decision and manage the resources. So that is another benefit that EOC has. Another important thing that EOC has is that it facilitates long-term operations, because I'll come in the later on part that it is an organization, it is a system, it is a place, it is a location which is self-sustained to a certain extent. And when the long-term operations are say enabled by the EOC, the continuity is maintained. Now, establishment of EOC. How EOC is established? You see in the top left corner is that EOC, there are two types of functions in any emergency. One, basic function, another is support function. So every state is functioning on certain principles. They have the emergency support functions, emergency support function desks. Maybe there are 14, but few of these states they club together. It's different from state to state. As Uttarakhand functions on seven desk ESF. So that emergency support functions are there, which has two type of functions, primary and secondary. See, in the present pandemic, the health department was the primary department, and all the support people, all the support agencies like food and civil supply, police, etc., revenue, they were all in the support functions. So the secondary function, all these agencies are providing secondary function, secondary support to the primary action point, that is health department. So you can establish the EOC either as an emergency support function, or you can establish EOC as an incident response function based. So what are the response functions? We all know these are the IRS functions, that is incident response system functions. That is, there has to be some policy group, that is the command functions. There has to be a planning function, there has to be operation function, there has to be logistic support function, there has to be finance function, there has to be multi-coordination effectiveness. So all these functions can find a base for establishing a EOC, or otherwise we have the ESFs that can form the base of the EUC establishment. But for any reason, for any for either of the two say setups, one underlying factor is that all the people who are sitting in the EUC must have that delegated authority to take decisions there and then. So that delegated authority, if you don't have, then EUCs will never function effectively. So that is there. Now, see, we were talking of the post-incident, pre-incident functions, why EUC can be established. We all say that EUCs must be function 24/7, 365 days. So for functioning of 24/7, 365 days, the pre-functions, pre-disaster functions are also to be performed by EUC. And what are those? You must work for the enhancement, you must work for the database development, you must work for the MOUs with different manufacturing agencies so that the resources can be procured at the time of emergency. You must have a close coordination with all the response agencies that are functioning within your area. You must have a close coordination with all the communication, power, other stakeholders that are there, the NGOs that are there, the community-based organizations that are there, the lower functionaries, that is local government that is there. You must also have a proper channel of analyzing and dissemination of the information. Collection, updation, analyzing, and dissemination of the information. You must have a clear roles and responsibilities, defined roles and responsibilities as to who has to do what in terms of pre-incident phases or pre-disaster phases. And at the same time, you must make the EOC self-sustained for a certain period of time so that if the disaster strikes, then EOC, irrespective of the power failure, irrespective of the communication failure, it can function and it can support the on-site operations. So that is what pre-incident functions EOC can play. And again, the training parts, mock drill parts, that can be taken up at the zero period by the EOCs. So that is where the EOCs can function in the pre-disaster phase as well. And they can also function, they can also undertake an activity of maintaining a close network and close repo with the DDMA and the community organization so that when the need arises, they have their support without waste of the time. Now, when you have established EOC, you have predefined forces, when to activate. You need, usually the control rooms are activated or EOCs are activated when you get a early warning of any impending disaster. You immediately notify that from today onwards, EOC is activated. And people who are designated to be part of EOC, they immediately come in and occupy the places of the EOC, meet with the delegated authorities, discuss with the EOC chairman, who usually at the district level is district magistrate. Or the another trigger point of activation of EOC is that there is a contingency plan. And an event that has come in without pre-notification, you can immediately activate the EOC as a contingency plan. So these are the major portion usually where EOC is activated, when EOC is activated. There are other trigger points also when EOC can be activated, is that if basically say it is multi-jurisdiction, multi-district event, so EOC has to be activated so as to have the close coordination and with the both agencies, with the both districts, and on ground emergencies. If multi agencies are involved, then EOC has to be activated, because with that EOC you will have a unified command, and that unified command can function as a single command authority to the operations. Immediate EOC activation is for any reason, if for certain area the life and property is at risk. See, immediately there is a rock fall. So for that reason, you have to establish an EOC. Immediately take care of, monitor the situation, take care of the people who are there. Or there is a fire, immediately. You need a EOC to cater to the, to address the situation of high risk. So that is where the EOCs are activated. Another situation where EOC can be activated is the when the need of resources is high. You need an EOC which can procure or provision the resources so that the operations are not affected. So that are some of the activation points, but the top two are usually the trigger points when EOCs are activated. EOCs activation may be local level. Few people come here and they take a decision, because that is not a major incident that has happened. So they take a decision, and EOC can be activated at that level. There can, since we say that 24/7, 365 days, the normal persons, one EOC commander, one EOC leader, one EOC manager, and with few support staff can man this situation on 24/7, 365 days. Maybe with the shifting of the duties. But if the situation becomes complex than the normal situation, then responsible for persons have to be there at the EOC limit. So, and when the situation is very grim, then the EOC fully is activated, with all persons, with all authorities, with all things. So there are four levels: level 4, 3, 2, 1, and one is the full activation of the authority. When we talk of actions that EOC within the EOC are taken, is that you have the authorities, there's a briefing of the situation, there is a briefing of the staffing requirements, there is a identification and briefing of the staffing requirements, you chalk out the daily plan, what has to be done, who will be there as a in charge of the EOC at say for a certain period, what will be the priority areas, what will be the priority areas to perform, what resources are to be needed, what coordination activities are to be performed by the EOC. So all these and current situation, current environmental situation, current site situation is also to be briefed for the people who are there in the EOC, so that everybody who is sitting in the EOC is at par and everybody has the same information, so that whatever contribution they can make as an individual or as an officer from the support functions, they can provide that. Daily operations, we all have been functioning that usually predefined functions can be taken up. You can set the timelines during the operations. You can set the timelines that this decision has to be taken, this action has to be performed by this time, so that when you are monitoring your activity, then you know that where for what reason you could not fulfill that, and you can evaluate your performance so that the next time when you are setting up your priorities, then you set up as per the objectives. You set up the objectives as per the resources or as per the current situation that can be performed. So when everything has been done, can you leave as it is? No. When the situation is stabilized, you have to deactivate the EOC. Situation is stabilized, you can deactivate the EOC. If you activate the EOC at a higher level and the situation has been managed at the lower level EOC, then the high level EOC can be deactivated. In charge of the disaster management in an area, he has the authority to activate or deactivate the EOC. At district level, it is DM, head of the DDMA. At state level, it is head of the vice chairman of the SDMA or the relief commissioner or disaster management secretary. At the national level, it is the NDMA or the secretary home. So they have the authority to deactivate or activate the EOC, because that must be laid down. So these are the three wheels or three important elements for effectiveness of the EOC. You must have the equipment, you must have the facilities, that is self-sustenance for certain days, and you must have the staff, trained staff, to perform the activities. Now, standard operation procedures, that is clear-cut roles and responsibilities of the people, who will do what, at what time, who is the authority to do that, with the delegated authorities, there has to be standard operating procedures of each and every element that has to be performed, activity that has to be performed. So that standard operating procedures must be there. And if you want to plan to establish an EOC, you must have all these things. That is, you must have a policy of establishing an EOC. You must have a strategic plan, that is how to perform, how or what activity is to be taken, when the EOC will be activated, when it will be deactivated, who will man the EOC. Everything should be there. Standard operating procedure should be there. The delegation of authority should be there. All the electronic gadgets and communication facilities should be there in the EOC. You should have trained staff. If not trained, then you must have a training facility. Self-sustenance of the EOC building, if it is a permanent building, and even if it is a temporary building, then the basic facilities, basic amenities are to be there for the EOC to function. Drills, mock drills, etc., are to be part of the EOC functions, and self-sustained facilities. And you must have the authority to function multi-jurisdictionally, because otherwise the EOC becomes a small control. So when we talk of EOC's role, so we were all talking about this, that on-site management is there, communication is there, coordination is there. And when the IRS comes in, there are certain response agencies will come in. And as a support to the response functions, what EOC has to do? EOC has to resolve the policy conflicts, if there are any, within the response agencies. Provide the right kind of information, disseminate that information, analyze the information, collect the information, and provide it. You must have a good communication facilities to get the information on site and from the IMD or other agencies, analyze at your level and disseminate. You must have the provision of providing and mobilizing the resources. The technological decision support systems like GIS, etc., the remote sensing data analysis, etc., they must be available as facilities in the EOC. So that is where EOC can support the incident response. This is what incident response. But the major role of EOC comes in when there is a multi-agency coordination needed, or the complexity of the situation. The briefing of the VIPs, the common picture, the common analysis of the part, the information that is going on should be from one area. The policy clarifications, the resource clarification, the resource mobilization, proper communication facility, redundant communication facility, dissemination of the information to the right person, getting information, the real-time information from the forecasting agencies or other such agencies. This is how EOC can support the incident response. An incident as a system, incident response as a system, has EOC as an overall part of the area. And it supports decision making. If we collect all the things and we summarize, then what are the support EOC provides to the IRS function is that activation of the IRT at the district level, higher level, provide information, provide sources, provide the delegation of the command, delegation of the authority, provide the right kind of information. Provide them with the situation analysis, gather the information of the from the forecasting agencies or other such agencies, site agencies, and collate that information, analyze that information, and call out the decisions and provide the situation information to the higher ups also and to the site people also. Brief the incident to the say media. Prepare the incident action plan so that the operations, the next set of operations can be taken up after one operational period. Better resource management is what EOC can support. Proper decision making is where EOCs can support. Liaisoning with external agencies is where EOC can support. Proper and managed VIP visits that EOC can support. And in all, monitoring the situation, the incident situation that is on ground, evaluating it, providing the strategies to revise the objectives or revise the strategies that you are maintaining for achieving the objectives is what EOC can support. This is how the system functions. You have a disaster management plan in place. You have ESFs in place. And once you receive the information of any disaster, what will happen? You immediately will invoke the activate the EOC. Levels, it depends on the disaster that is there. You will immediately activate the DM plan, you will immediately get the support of the emergency support functions. You can get the information of the resources from the IDRN, and IRTs can be activated. So this is the overall situation, that how things are managed, and there is an important portion of UOC which has the clear cut from the agencies to function. Information tracking, we all know that collect the information from the different sources, on-site sources, forecasting agencies, other sources which can affect the operations that are going on. Analyze those information at EOC. Get an output of that EOC. Provide that to the get that ground truthing also done for the information. And then based on that ground truthing, finalize the information to be passed on to the media and passed on to the site and higher ups, and document that event. So this is how information tracking can be done by the EOCs. So when we talk of EOC and IRS, there has to be some difference. So when we talk of IRS, it is an on-site management because it's on-site. And when we talk of EOC, it is an off-site management. It provides support to the IRS. IRS is always temporary in nature, but EOC can be temporary, but mostly permanent. Because IRS is activated and then deactivated, demobilized, mobilized and demobilized. IRS is basically on ground, so it is a tactical management system, while EOC is a strategic and support, because it supports to finalize the tactics. It is under the responsible officer, who is at the district level DM or various authority at the down below level. However, EOC is under DDMA or some specified agency. IRS manages at an incident or an event, particular incident or an event, while EOC can manage multiple events at the same time and while performing the other DM functions as well. So this is how IRS and EOC are different, yet they are dependent on each other. So thank you very much. This was from my side, as information to be provided to the participants. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for this valuable presentation on the EOC linkages and the many more things you have highlighted to all the participants. So participant, now I request you that if you have any query, you can ask question. You can write down in a chat box, or you can raise your hand so that I can unmute you to ask your question. Nitish, would you like to ask something? Nitish? Yes, please ask your question. V. Pantula? Hello? Hello.
Can we have this PPT?
Yes, we can share with the Rajamani sir, or we can provide you.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, hello. Am I audible?
Yes, 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 you are, please.
This is Sardar Ramiz from actually Kashmir. I was listening keenly to Sheikh Sir's presentation, very wonderfully presented, especially the differences between how IRS and DOC actually function and differentiate. What I want to ask is that, the activation time of EOC or in fact IRS depends on the kind of disaster we are actually facing or the impending disaster. So how is we have technological inputs, we have technology now at our service, and how is the IR going to help us, AI rather, going to help us in activation of, quick activation of EOC and IRS? So number one. Number second is that do you think that different disasters have different kind of, I mean, setup of EOC, and if so, what are they? Thank you so much.
Sardar Ramiz, I'll start with your second question first. Basically, you initially start the EOCs, preferably what I say is that ESFs, based on the ESF functions. So it is based on ESF functions, and as you have different disasters, so the primary responsibility of the ESF functions changes. So the entire major contribution or major decision making at the EOC changes as per the disasters. So it is always advisable to have that EOC established in terms of ESFs. So there is no hard and fast rule as to what exactly or EOC is to be different for different disasters. That is not the case. The only difference is that you can have EOC as a permanent location or as a temporary location. So if the disaster is such that you need a permanent location, you can activate that permanent location, or otherwise if the need arises, then EOC can be a temporary location with minimum basic facilities. So there is no clear-cut demarcation as to EOC should be different for different disasters. So this is one. Number two, as far as AI is concerned, the AI basically is a support function for conducting, taking up various other functions. So in terms of IRS and EOC activation, the AI can help in terms of updating the information, monitoring the situation, and providing the real-time information at the EOC, so that the activation time of IRS can be managed based on the AI information along with the ground truthing. So this is one. As far as EOC is concerned, I would always suggest that EOC should function 24/7, 365 days with bare minimum people, so that whatever amenities are there in the EOC, they are being utilized, and at the time of emergency, you will find that many of the if you are not using the EOC, you will find that many of the equipments or the gadgets or the facilities that are available in the EOC, they are non-functional. So to avoid that, I would always suggest that the EOCs with bare minimum people should function 24/7, 365 days. Even you can have that updation of the knowledge, in providing information to the community, providing information to the people who are going to conduct the training programs or something. So that is what is a suggestion from my side, but it all depends on state to state as to what their own policies are there when it comes down to the activation or establishment of the
Yes. But I have two quick questions to Shekhar sir also, if you allow me.
Number
first is that do we have a data, I mean, software system which we can, I mean, readily available, which can be used elsewhere if developed one part of India or one state of India, which can be used elsewhere in any other state of India? Number one. Number second is that what do you think about scaling down the EOC to the smallest level, what could be the possible, I mean, scenario to scale down to the lowest possible level, I mean, in the departments or in different sub-sectors of any department?
Yes, we can scale down. See, normal times you can have the L4 level EOC, wherein bare minimum people can, and you can also have the department EOCs, which usually can provide the say information sought by the main EOC that is there. So that can be there is no problem. But for the second question, that the database that is available for utilization of AI or utilization of other electronic say nowcast or something on with the EOC, that right now I don't have an information, but as soon as I get the information, I'll share it with you.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, is there any template wherein we can just have a look at the EOCs and how they operate? Any kind of a documentation available, sir?
Yes, documentation is available. I'll share with Mr. Rajamani. You can have it from them.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Participant, if you have any more question, please ask. Otherwise, we will go for a valedictory. I think there is no more question. So, TikTok Janice, which are taught now? Question you have for him.
Mr. Nagarajan, you have asked for two important questions, which are well taken. Regarding the first question, that is the educational and training institutions to take steps to train the students in first aid. Usually they are provisions now being taken up by various organizations such as St. John's Ambulance and Red Cross, who are going in for the trainings of the NSS people and the NCC people on all these aspects of basic life support, first aid, CPR, swimming, etc. So they are taking up and in collaboration with various educational and training institutions. Regarding the second question, of voluntary encroachment and occupying low-lying areas. So see, what this is basically a political issue, and I would not like to majorly comment on that. But yes, as far as I am concerned, maybe if we as a service provider can accommodate them in certain areas where such disasters say are not say regular, or you can say it is not voluntarily encroachment, and if you can evacuate them and put them in some place with some basic amenities which can provide them a certain dignified level of living, then I think this problem can be solved. But as of now, usually we find at many places this is being done. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Manisha Kumari ji, there is no particular attendance sheet for our this particular program, as you have enrolled in our training portal, national. So we have an IDM training portal. So you have to visit that particular portal and you have to register and enroll. Our registration process will be closed in 2 days, midnight at 12 p.m. So if you have not registered till yet, so please do that, and please use your this common and this email address which you have used to join this particular webinar. Otherwise, you will be not received any certificate from IDM side. Participants, I just make announcement here that it is compulsory to all the participants, those who have attended this training program and have not enrolled themselves at an IDM training portal. You please go and enroll yourself with the same email address which you have used for this joining the program. This is mandatory for the certification, and regarding the certificate, you will be rewarded a certificate, those who have met the 80% of attendance in this webinar. Thank you. Now, as we have not no any more questions, so we are proceeding for our validatory address. For that, I would like to invite Shekhar sir to please give a summing up note from your side and later on. Thank you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Arun, for giving me the opportunity of proposing the validatory address to the participants. In that validatory address, the only thing that I can say is that it is always necessary to prepare for a disaster in terms of response, also in terms of mitigation, also identify what resources you have, how much resources you can use, you have an access to. And access, always get an access to the DM plan of your area, because that will provide you with the history also and with the possible support agencies also, where you can contact in terms of when any disaster strikes. And as the questions were raised by the participants regarding the AI and the electronic support system, so that is available with the higher education institutions who are say with the higher education institutions in terms of research. They are providing research on these topics, and also the various agencies have that AI facilities which can help in terms of providing real time information and near accurate information, which one must have that ground truthing done, so that whatever actions you are taking are as per the policy guidelines, as per the resources available, and as per the ground reality. So one must be ready, one must be prepared, and if you are prepared, then once you yourself be prepared, and then try to save others, so that whatever investment has been done on you by your parents, by your institution, by your neighbors, that doesn't go waste. And always be ready to contribute towards effective disaster management in the country, and put one foot forward for making the country resilient in terms of disasters. Thank you. I hope whatever queries you had, whatever in say expectations you had for today's program. I was able to meet your expectations, and NIDM was able to deliver what you had expected from NIDM. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Sir,
hello. Yes, please.
Sir, can you just guide regarding the registration? I just opened the NIDM portal.
Okay, there is an option for a this register or enrolled now. So you have to go to register on this option, which is showing the register. And after clicking this register option, you have to fill your personal information like your name, email address, phone number, place or something like that. There is a small performer. After filling this performer, you have to just give your email address or a password, which will be a confirmation.
I mean, I couldn't get the register thing, sir. It is a login is there. I don't find a register thing. In that email login. And yeah.
Okay, just
Nitesh, have you already registered earlier?
No, sir. I just enrolled into the program through our district collector's office. I provided them the details, but I'm not sure if I have.
No. There is an option for login, in which below this login there is an option email and password.
Yes, sir.
Have you got this?
Yes,
and
sir,
just
sir,
below
sir.
That there is an option for new user.
Yes,
new
sir.
User.
Okay. Yes, yes. Got
and
it.
Then you have to click on this register form.
Fine, no? I got it, sir. Got it.
Okay.
Right, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Right. Now this it's time to close down for the today's webinar on the emergency operation center. So I, Arun Verma, take this opportunity to thank all the participants who have joined us today for this webinar on emergency operation center. I would like to thank Sri Rajam Maniji from GVMC to give a chance to us for conducted a webinar, and I would like to thanks the Commissioner GVMC, Ma'am Sejna ji, who was giving us permission to conduct this webinar. Now, I would like to thanks our Executive Director, Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal sir, who for her overall guidance to this particular webinar on the emergency, and his overall guidance is appreciable efforts from his side that he has give permission to us to conduct this particular webinar. I would like to thanks all the participants who have joined us through the various mechanisms, various modes, laptop and mobile phones after their busy schedules. So I would like to thanks all them, and I would like to thanks our course coordinator and the extreme speaker Sri Shekhar Chaturvedi sir, who have joined us and give enlightened us on the EOC emergency operations center and overview and its linkages with the incident response system. I'd like to thanks all the participants and all the dignitaries who was presenting this particular webinar from NIDM side and side of GVMC. Thank you, participants. As I earlier told you, if you feel any difficulty related to the downloading of your certificates, then I will ultimately help you out. And I just want to say here that after your registration, or those who have already registered in our training portal, they have to go to the completed event. After a week, they will have to visit our portal again, and they have to visit completed event, and then you will showing this particular program, and there is a link for the feedback. You just click on that feedback form and fill at that moment, and then directly it will go to the certificate portal. So you will download your certificate and you can take up. If those who have not made the 80% of attendance in this portal, they are not eligible for the certificates. So I once again thank you all the participants. Thank you so much.